Thank you, and good evening and welcome. I'm Dr. Sam Keith, and I'm the Director of Ideas in Psychiatry. Welcome to our IDEAS. It stands for the Institute for the Development of Education and Advancement of Science in Psychiatry, and is a part of the Department of Psychiatry. It started with a very generous, anonymous gift from a grateful family. We're about education, bringing in national and international experts for training and teaching of our faculty, our fellows, our residents, and medical students, both within the department and, when appropriate, within the university. Education for mental health providers is also part of our charge, and other health professionals within our community and beyond. And finally, education for our community, and that's why we're here this evening. A few words about this evening. After Mrs. Carter's presentation, there will be a short question and answer period, with questions selected from those submitted by you, the audience, onto our website. And once the question and answer period is finished, the book signing line will open, not before, but after the question and answer period. Please read your programs for the full details of how that line will work. And now, let me introduce former First Lady Rosalynn Carter, who has worked for more than three decades to improve the quality of life for people around the world. Today, she is an advocate for mental health itself, for caregiving and caregivers, early childhood immunization, human rights, and conflict resolution through her work at the Carter Center in Atlanta, Georgia. A full partner with the president in all the center's activity, the former First Lady is a member of the Carter Center Board of Trustees. She created and chairs the Carter Center's Mental Health Task Force, an advisory body of experts, consumers, and advocates promoting positive change for the mental health field. Each year, she hosts the Rosalynn Carter Symposium on Mental Health Policy, bringing together leaders of the nation's health organizations to address critical issues. A mother of four, Mrs. Carter has maintained a lifelong dedication to issues affecting women and children. In 1991, she launched with Mrs. Betty Bumpers, wife of former U.S. Senator Dale Bumpers of Arkansas, the Every Child by Two program, a nationwide campaign to publicize the needs of early childhood immunizations. She also works with Habitat for Humanity, Project Interconnections, a public-private nonprofit partnership to provide housing for homeless people who are mentally ill. She served as Distinguished Centennial Lecturer at Agnes Scott College in Decatur, Georgia, from 1988 to 1992, and is currently a Distinguished Fellow at the Emory University Department of Women's Studies in Atlanta. Mrs. Carter has written five books. Her autobiography, The First Lady from Plains. Next, Everything to Gain, Making the Most of the Rest of Your Life, a book about life after the White House, co-authored with President Carter. Helping Yourself Help Others, a book for caregivers. Helping Someone with Mental Illness, a compassionate guide for family, friends, and caregivers, which was selected as the winner of the 1999 American Society of Journalists and Authors Outstanding Book Award in the service category. And finally, her most recent book, Within Our Reach, Ending the Mental Health Crisis. Mrs. Carter continues to travel and speak throughout the world, is a deacon at the Maranatha Baptist Church in Plains, Georgia, and enjoys fly fishing, bird watching, swimming, and biking in her relatively small amount of free time. Please join me in welcoming a former First Lady, Rosalynn Carter.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. And thank you, Sam, for that introduction. You can tell Sam's a good friend. He said all of those nice things about me. And he is a good friend. I've known Sam for a long time. I worked with him when he was at the National Institute of Mental Health. I always had great admiration for him. He's not only a good friend of mine, he's a good friend of mental health, and I think you all know that. Well, I have been working on mental health issues for more than 41 years, if you can believe that. I became interested in campaigning for Jimmy for governor. This was in 1966. He ran one time and lost. And we got in late because our candidate had a heart attack. But it was a time when the Community Mental Health Centers Act had been signed, and it required community mental health center in reach of every person in our country that needed help. But what was happening was, before the community centers were established, they were beginning to move people out of those big old institutions that where everybody was so crowded. There was a big expose of ours. It had thousands and thousands of people. And I think it was supposed to have 3,000. I think it had about 12,000 people there. It was happening all over the United States. And every day when I campaigned, this was the first time I had campaigned, so I was surprised at how people just pour their heart out to you about their problems. And every day people were asking me, if your husband's elected governor, what will he do for my mentally ill loved one who's at Central State? Well, I kept hearing it over and over and over. So one day I asked Jimmy, what are you going to do for people with mental illnesses when you're governor of Georgia? And he said, we're going to have the best program in the country, and I'm going to put you in charge of it. Well, he didn't put me in charge of it, of course, because I didn't know anything about it. But he did create the Governor's Commission to Improve Services to the Mentally and Emotionally Handicapped. And I became a member. He made me a member of that committee. That was the beginning of my education about mental health issues. And then I had a President's Commission on Mental Health. We worked very hard, passed the Mental Health Systems Act, signed 1 month before Jimmy was involuntarily retired from the White House. And it was not a perfect bill, but it would have had a great impact on services and support for those living with mental illnesses if, and it's a big if, the new president hadn't just put it on the shelf and never implemented it. It was one of the biggest disappointments of my life. Well, now, since we left the White House, I have a really good program at the Carter Center, mental health program. We work constantly to try to overcome stigma and influence policy. And my work over this very long time has been both rewarding and frustrating. It's rewarding because the great changes in the field. Today, because of research and our new knowledge of mental health issues, of the brain, new knowledge of the brain, the overwhelming majority of those living with mental illnesses, even those with serious mental illness, can recover and lead full and productive lives in the community. Go into school, working, raising families, and we are even talking about prevention. These are things I never dreamed would happen, and nobody dreamed it would happen when I became involved. To me, recovery is the biggest advancement in the last 41 years. I think it's the biggest advancement ever in mental health care. It brings hope to consumers. And consumers are those living with mental illness. It brings hope to consumers and to practitioners alike. And it's really exciting to see what happens. I have a friend, his name is Joel Slack, and he's a consumer living with mental illness. And he's a member of my mental health task force at the Carter Center. He lost 8 years of his life, he said, to a mental illness that developed when he returned home after his freshman year in college. And he said that he lay on his back for 2.5 years in residential psychiatric hospital. And then he said he lived in group homes and supervised housing and day treatment programs, the whole gamut of things. But after 8 years, he went back to college. He finished. Now he owns his own consulting business, a very successful businessman living with a mental illness. And I have seen so many people in the same situation, serious mental illness, that have recovered and live full and productive lives. It's so exciting to me from the beginning, 41 years ago, when nobody would even admit having a person in their family with a mental illness, and still people don't, but it's so different today. Still some people do, but it's so different today, and so much has happened. But the frustrating part is that so many people suffer unnecessarily. What is so sad is we know what to do. We know what to do, and we don't do it. Today, mental illnesses can be diagnosed. We have excellent knowledge about effective treatments, good models for delivering them. We have early intervention strategies to prevent more serious problems later in life. We're even beginning to understand how to promote resiliency in children at risk, and in those struggling with the most serious disorders. And that means helping them develop a sense of purpose and confidence, and giving them the ability to succeed when adversities come along in life. I have one colleague who says it helps them live well, work well, and love well. And I think that's what most people like to do. Well, I put some of the blame on all of this, on stigma. It's the biggest obstacle to helping people with mental illness. It keeps people from seeking help. They don't want to go because they don't want to be labeled mentally ill. It curtails funding for programs. It leads to discrimination and prejudice that is devastating. It's not just about hurting someone's feelings, but it can result in discriminatory practices in housing and transportation, education, and insurance that directly impacts the functioning and quality of a person's life. I dream of the day when there's no more stigma. I feel like I've been working on it all of my life. And recent polls show that we're making a little bit of progress now, but we have a long way to go to reduce the stigma on serious mental illnesses like schizophrenia and bipolar. In fact, the last poll I saw showed that stigma in some instances is even becoming stronger against serious mental illnesses. We have to find a good way to overcome the stigma. The main reasons that I think, there are many reasons for stigma. The main reason, I think, is the fear factor. People fear that those with these illnesses are unpredictable and potentially violent. We know that the media depictions of mental illness perpetuate these misconceptions. The truth is that those living with mental illnesses are more likely to be victims of violence rather than perpetrators. In fact, they're 4 times more likely to have a violent crime committed against them than just the average person walking down the street. Well, I wrote my book, Within Our Reach, Ending the Mental Health Crisis, because I want people to know what I know. I want everybody to know what I know, so we can get on with stigma, do away with stigma, and get on with doing what is good and right for those living with mental illnesses. The themes of the book are recovery, and I've already touched on a couple of these. I touched on recovery. Prevalence. Mental illnesses touch every family in America. Think about your own personal situation. I'm pretty sure you know someone who right now is struggling with depression or some other mental or emotional problem. Approximately 1 in 4 adults in our country is affected every year. 1 out of 5 children. These illnesses do not discriminate. They touch every part of our society. Well, stigma is another of our themes, and I've already talked about that, but prevention is the other theme. Early intervention and prevention have the potential to reduce the risk and severity of mental illness, especially among children. We have learned through research that mental illnesses are developmental diseases. That's something we never dreamed before. For years, we didn't think children had lived long enough to have problems and to have depression. or mental illnesses. And I look forward to the day when every mother of a baby takes that baby to a well baby clinic for mental illnesses, just like they do to a well baby clinic for physical illnesses. If that was done and people went continuously with their children to well baby clinics, the earliest you can detect mental illness, the better it is, because you can mitigate the disease, lessen it, and sometimes even prevent an episode from ever occurring. It is so important. I want all mothers to know to take the baby for a well baby examination. Don't think about people think you're going for because something's wrong. Just take the baby to be sure that it's okay. Well, my hope is that my book will help dispel the myths and misconceptions about mental illnesses that cause so many to keep their problems hidden and hinder all our efforts to help them. Everyone who suffers from mental illnesses deserves treatment and a chance for recovery. Well, this evening I thought I might touch on some topics that are getting a lot of attention right now in the mental health field, and some that we're working on at the Carter Center. One is behavioral health of returning veterans, taking care of veterans returning with PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, or traumatic brain injuries, or depression, and also from suffering from substance use. We have an annual symposium at the Carter Center, and we talk about current issues, and we have the leading people in the field for the particular issue we're talking about. We have national, state, and local government officials that come. We have advocates who attend. And the topic of our annual symposium in 2010 was behavioral health needs of returning veterans. And we particularly focused on those of National Guard and Reserves, because those that are career service members come back mostly to bases where they have support, and their families often live on the bases and they have some support. National Guard and Reserves come back home to places like Plains, Georgia. We have a population of 634, our hometown. But they come back to places, and often there are programs for them, but it's hard for them to access them. They don't know about them or how to access them. And one good thing is that everybody in our country, I think, is concerned about our veterans coming home and want them to have the best possible care. And that gives us in the mental health field a chance to talk about a mental health issue that people are interested in. That helps everybody in the mental health field and those living with mental illnesses. In our symposium, we talked about services and support needed. We also discussed the wives and parents who are becoming caregivers for their husbands or their adult children returning from deployment. And one thing that is particularly worrisome to me is the way these fathers coming home and mothers coming home from war affects the children. Not all are doing well, especially when their parents are deployed frequently and for longer period of times. We found that so many of them suffer from trauma, just as some of their parents do. Well, another issue that's gaining attention right now in the mental health field is integration of care. We have an initiative at the Carter Center looking at integrating primary care and mental health and substance use services. We have brought together the primary care leaders in the country and the behavioral health, that's mental health and substance use. At the national leader, we brought the national leaders together and around the concept of a patient-centered medical home. And there's been great interest in the country. And now we're working at the state level, bringing together mental health providers with other health providers to form a partnership so that they can jointly serve their patients. And To me, it's really important, because what we have learned is that people with mental illnesses die 25 years younger than others. And it's because if they have an illness, if they have a heart problem, they keep a heart problem. They don't usually get help for it if they have any kind of problem. And they're dying from just the illnesses that other people have. So what we're trying to do in Georgia is bring the primary care doctor of a professional into the clinic, into the mental health clinic, to be sure that those with mental illnesses get good quality care. Well, we have a Georgia program, a Georgia forum every year. But for the first time, we've been working in the community with the advocates. There was a big expose of the Central State Hospital many years ago, but there's a big expose in the newspaper of our mental facilities several years ago, and 136 deaths were found that could have been avoided, such as bowel obstruction, things that, if there were good care, would never have happened. And so the United States Justice Department investigated and filed suit against the state. And our mental health program joined advocates as a friend of the court. It was long and drawn out, and I have a grandson now who's an attorney in Atlanta, and he said, and he was also elected to the state senate last year, so I'm excited about that. But he said we got the judge in the state that put everything off, and he put it off, but we finally got a settlement, and it was a good settlement. And I will always remember, I don't remember what year, probably 2009, I'm not sure, but it was on October the 19th. I'll never forget that, because that's Amy Carter's birthday. And now we have great reform going on in our state. The settlement said that we have to, in 5 years, establish community facilities for everybody in the state that needs help. That's just incredible. And if you can believe it, we got an increase in our budget for mental health last year in Georgia. I don't think there are many states. I don't think there are many states that can say that. So, and while we were working with advocates on the settlement, we were able to get a grant to develop a vision of what a really good model mental health services program could be. What happened was, that it was, as we were working on that, and we had this one wonderful woman doing the work, and she was going to the state looking for statistics and things the state didn't even know they had. And they got interested in what we were doing and started working with us on this program. And now they've been with us. The commissioner has been with us as we've been holding public hearing across the states. There's really, really excitement about it. And we have in our state now the chance to develop a model program for the country. I'm really excited about that. I didn't know that would ever happen. Well, I'm talking too long, but there's several things that are disturbing to me, and I want to share these with you. And one is the Parity Bill. We passed the Parity Bill. The Parity Bill was passed in 2008. It was a great achievement. It was providing insurance, having to provide mental health coverage on a par with coverage for other health issues. And we celebrated. But still today, we do not have the final regulations for implementing the law. That is so frustrating to me. And I have good contacts in Washington. well, the head of the Department of Health and Human Services, Kathleen Sebelius, father was governor when Jimmy was governor. I've known him forever. And Hilda Solis, the head of the Department of Labor, was an intern in Jimmy's office when he was president. And I've been working with them. But their hands are tied by the White House. I've called the White House, in fact, they asked me to, And the one in the Health and Human Services that goes that every month when they set the priorities, every month parity bill is on that as a priority, but then they say it is, and then when the list of priorities is issued, it's not on there. And what I learned is that they want to make it a part of the Affordable Health Care Act, which is so distressing to me. The parity bill has already passed, and we in the mental health community didn't want it to be part of the new health care bill. But just about 3 weeks ago, a White House official in a press conference said that parity would be in the health care bill, but that since the states decide on how Medicaid is spent, there would be different versions of the law initiated in the states, which is not right. And Medicaid is the largest payer for mental health and substance use treatment services. And Medicaid reform is inevitable, especially at the state level. Georgia is already that's already going on in Georgia. So we all need to be vigilant and get organized so that we don't lose what we've gained through the passage of the parity law in the coming weeks and months ahead as the Health Care Act becomes enacted. And we have to be concerned about that too, the Health Care Act, because and if it's struck down, or even parts of it are struck down, there's going to be some kind of a health care reform legislation. And with states evidently having a lot of latitude in determining the actual plans that are available for their citizens, there is a great potential for disparities among the states here too. And that's not what the health care bill was supposed to be. With the changes in Medicaid, what's going to happen in the health care bill, which could be struck down entirely. This could have profound impact on the accessibility of quality health services for those we in the mental health field care about. As mental health advocates, it is incumbent on all of us to ensure that mental health and substance use issues are fully considered and included in whatever kind of health care legislation is passed. Well, to me, the way we treat people, those living with mental illness in our country, is a moral issue. To neglect those who, through no fault of their own, are in need, and we do that, and we treat them like second-class citizens. And this runs counter to our values of decency and equality. Today, with our knowledge and expertise, we have a great opportunity to change things forever for all people with mental illnesses, to move forward to a new era of understanding, care, and respect. We cannot let this opportunity slip away. Thank you very much.
Thank you ever so much for such an inspiring and wonderful run through what many of us have spent our lives trying to improve. We'll now turn to questions and answers. And the questions have been selected from those of you who sent in questions onto our online webpage. And just to remind you that the lines will not form for the book signing until the question and answer period is over. But please refer to your programs for the do's and don'ts of this wonderful opportunity. So now we'll turn to the questions and answers. Thank you, Mrs. Carter. From your time in the White House to the present, do you think we've made progress? And what do you see?
We've made a lot of progress in mental health issues. Because when we got to the White House, people were still afraid to talk about mental illnesses.
That's right.
And still didn't want to admit that there was mental illness in the family. And we did tours all across the country, and some incredible stories of how people had been treated, and what we with the President's Commission. And we're trying to find out the issues, learn the issues and what was happening. And there was no dream of ever being able to recover or have a good life. I know when we did our report on that President's Commission, we didn't mention recovery. And actually, I wrote a book in the late 1990s, the first one I wrote on mental health. I didn't mention, even late 1990s, we never thought about recovery. So we've come a very long way. We still have a long way to go on stigma. But there's great research going on. We're learning new things about the brain every day. And there's so many exciting things like the programs for elderly. I have found that elderly people are the hardest to get to admit that they have depression or mental health. My mother was that way. She was in an assisted living home, and one day I called her and I said, "How are you getting along, Mom?" And she said, "Well, they sent a psychiatrist in to see me. They think I'm crazy." I said, "Mother, I've worked for years on this." But they would not have a psychiatrist in the assisted living home, and I would go there, and everybody could just somebody to cheer them up and let them know that mental illness is not just a part of growing old, because that's what they think it is. It's just a part of the growing old. And also, they grew up in a time when it was, you know, it was a terrible thing, and nobody wanted to know about it. I really think it's going to change today, because I think young people are more willing to say that they have a mental illness now.
I also think that even though we didn't get the full benefit of the President's Mental Health Commission, that it called attention to it at a time when research was just sort of beginning to take hold in terms of mental illness. And I think we've seen a burgeoning of interest in that, and the fact that we have moved the field forward has made a major difference in how people now look at mental illness. Mm-hmm. So Jimmy, we thank you for that.
When Jimmy was president, he greatly expanded the funding for research. Yes. Mm-hmm. I was proud of that.
The next question is, can an individual person make a difference?
I think everybody can make a difference. I think if they go to the Carter Center website and call up the mental health program, there's a lot they can learn. But I think that if somebody has a mental illness, is in recovery, leading a great life, if they talk about it, it lets other people know. And say, look, he's living with a mental illness. He's doing good. It takes away a little bit of the fear. And I forgot what I was talking about.
Well, I think that we've had Dr. Kay Jamison and Dr. Mark Vonnegut join us in talking about their experiences, and I would agree with you. I think it makes a huge difference.
It makes a difference, but people can learn about mental illnesses in the first place. They can volunteer in a mental health facility. Mental health facilities always need volunteers. The things they can do, talking to their neighbors and friends, and if they know somebody with a mental illness, who has a mental illness, have a woman at home that I go to see all the time, and to just let them know that they're not afraid of them and that they respect them. I have one, Joel Slack, the one that was so sick for so long, said that the main thing that helps a person with mental illness is to have respect from someone. And if you just have respect, because they're people, and they don't like to be, and we identify them by the illness. When they're not the mentally ill person, they're a person living with mental illness. They're people first.
Thank you. With so many women aging alone, what do you see as the top mental health challenge or priority for this over 70 population?
Well, I think for over 70 is the same thing for everybody. Well, what makes a good quality of life, I think, is to be doing something meaningful and have some social contact, because so many people are isolated and live alone. And women live longer than men, and so therefore they see more losses in their life of maybe a husband or even a child or good friends. And so I think if stay busy if they can, which is not always easy for mentally ill people. But if they, and one thing that I started to say a while ago about people, elderly people, was Jürgen Unnutzer, do you know Jürgen? Mm-hmm. In Seattle, I think?
Yes.
He started a program for elderly, put in a mental health clinician in the clinic that the elderly people go to, who talks to them. You can almost tell when somebody is suffering from depression. They're sad and don't feel good. And this person in the clinic has just proven to be invaluable. It helps people. They let them know that mental illness is not a part of growing old and that they can overcome it. And it just, from all that I hear about this program, it's just worked wonders in the places they put these mental health conditions. And I think that's the reason I think that it's so important. If I know so many people that go to the doctor, but if they had somebody there that could talk to them like that and say it's all right to feel this way, it makes such a difference.
I agree with you completely. You've traveled a great deal. What differences have you found in other cultures with regard to mental illness? And are there things we could learn? Are some people getting it right?
I think they're getting it right in good many places, Scandinavian countries and some other countries. But one thing that we've done now is, well, with all of our Carter Center programs, whether we're working on healthcare or conflict resolution or anything, when we go into a country, the program we do is the country's program. I mean, if we go into a village and teach people how to stop drinking water with a guinea worm and if it gives them an illness, we teach them how. We don't give money to the government. We teach them how, and they do it themselves. It makes a total difference. So it's theirs and it's their culture. The way they do it is the way they would do it naturally in their culture, and it's different in different places. But culture is really important, and we just started, and this is the first time the Carter Center's ever done that. I have a committee of international women leaders for mental health, but we just exchange information about what we're doing and so forth. But this is the first time we've ever been to a country outside the United States, and we've started a program in Liberia. We have lots of programs in Liberia, and health programs, and we helped set up the judicial system and do some other things after the war was finished a couple of years ago. But this is a country that has been in civil war for more than a decade, had been, and everybody's traumatized. But we started this program, and they have one psychiatrist in Liberia. And we have trained 39 psychiatric nurses and physician's assistants, and now they're in every district in Liberia. Our goal is to do. Our goal is to do 150. And actually, I work with Columbia University a lot on my mental health program. And there was a woman, Jane Knitzer. There was a woman there she died a couple of years ago. But she wrote a book on children, and 25 years later, she wrote another one. But anyway, Janice Cooper was her assistant at Columbia. And Janice Cooper is Liberian. She resigned to go to Liberia to run our program. It's totally in Liberian culture. And she's also a good friend of the president who is Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, a woman who lived in the United States for a long time, but she was elected, so they got along. And our program, we just got the outcomes of what had happened. We have everybody at the Carter Center is measured by outcomes. I got away with it for a long time. Have you helped overcome stigma with mental illness? That's hard, but anyway, I'm trying to do it now.
The outcomes from Liberia.
Yeah, and the outcomes were so good. The whole evaluation was just wonderful. I'm excited about that.
That's a wonderful program.
And we are also now we have other countries in that area wanting to copy our Liberia program. So that's great too.
Mm-hmm. Well, I remember
most of these countries don't have anything, you know.
I know. I remember being the editor of a journal, the Schizophrenia Bulletin. I met a psychiatrist from Tanzania once, and he asked me, because they didn't have hard currency, if we could send them, the psychiatrists in Tanzania, copies of the Schizophrenia Bulletin. And I said, well, how many psychiatrists are there? And he says, well, two. While I'm out of the country, the other person's covering. So, yes. Television, movies, and print media often depict mental illness inaccurately and from a very negative perspective. How can we help change this?
Well, I'm working on it.
Yes.
I actually have, and it's true, they perpetuate the stigma. It's better than it used to be, but it's still not really good. It's better than it used to be because the mental health community has gotten together and they have, they watch the programs. And when a television program, a movie or something depicts a mentally ill person in the wrong way, they get tons of mail going to them about it, criticizing them and telling them how wrong, what a bad thing they're doing. Television and I have at the Carter Center mental health fellowships for journalists. And we bring them to the Carter Center. They apply with a title, a subject that they want to study. We give them $10,000. They don't leave their job. They write about an issue. They come once a year to talk about what they're going to do. They come back at the end of the year and tell us what they did. Some come in between times too. And we have about 120 probably now from the United States that have been through. And it's so exciting because I'm reading things that they've written. And once they get interested, they have, so many of them have continued to work on mental health stories, good mental health stories, about people who've recovered and doing great things. And when they cover, if you have noticed in the last few years, some of the things that could have been written about sensationally or talked about sensationally have rather had kind of the background of the person, and almost who did the act, almost without exception, it's somebody that the mental health system failed. And so I'm proud of that. We expanded the program. We have one in New Zealand now, one in South Africa, and one in Romania. We fund them, we help them raise the funds for 5 years, and at 5 years they're on their own. And New Zealand's on their own, South Africa's on their own, and we're working with Romania now. We're looking for a country next in Latin America for journalism. So we're getting journalists all over the country, all over the world, to report accurately. We had one man from Oregon who said that there were 6 articles in the newspaper. He was an Oregonian. He said there were 6 articles in the paper the year before he got the fellowship, and the year, mostly negative, and the year he had the fellowship, there were 66, mostly positive. And actually, it spilled over to into the state because they started writing something about a mental health facility. Anyway, the people in the state jumped on them, and they had to close the facility and make it do a better job. Anyway, I'm kind of proud of them. That was what I was supposed to have the outcomes of, whether my mental fellowship journalism program was doing anything to lessen stigma. And we've had I'm supposed to let the, to report at board meetings, and we've had three, I think, sessions with experts in stigma come across the country, and we're really working on trying to see how we can measure stigma and whether it's up or down.
I think that's a really great undertaking, and I liked one of your earlier points, particularly since it tied in with one of our other questions. What can one person do? Well, as you see portrayals in the newspaper or on television or in the movies or wherever that are unfair, that are not doing a service to the community, mm-hmm. pick up the phone, write a letter. You know, it's not like the power going out in your neighborhood and you're pretty sure your neighbor called the power company. Mm-hmm. You should call the power company. And you should make those statements so that they hear them. And you can write op-ed pieces
That's
in
right.
the newspaper. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very important that you know, it's not for somebody else to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's so many people that are affected by mental illnesses. And I still don't see why stigma, even the fear factor, is so strong, because everybody knows people living
yes.
with mental illnesses. And every family has, if not a person in the family, a close friend or relative with a mental illness. And so I don't know, but it persists.
And sometimes the mentally ill aren't good advocates for themselves, and I think mm-hmm. they need the help that we can give them,
right.
such as you've been doing.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's such an important step mm-hmm. forward.
And knowing that people can recover, I mean, you cannot imagine the effect it has on somebody who's been suffering from mental illness for years. To have somebody who has been through what they're going through talk to them and saying, look at me, I know exactly what you are, I was right there where you are, and now I have this business, now I'm recovered. And it just brings hope, where in the past any kind of diagnosis of mental illness was left people hopeless.
Yes.
And without thinking they would have any kind of good future at all.
And our last question for this evening. There's so much to do and so many setbacks along the way. How do you keep going and keep your wonderful optimism?
Well, I see good things happening in the mental health field. I think that's the reason I can stay optimistic about it, because I see so many people who've recovered and living good lives now, who had been sick forever. I don't know. I think, as I said before, I think that if you feel like you're doing something worthwhile and you stay active, I think it does a lot to keep you young. I need to be kept young because I'm getting old.
You've done a wonderful job with that. Before you leave the stage this evening, on behalf of all of us, we would like to present you with a New Mexico storyteller from the Jemez Pueblo.
One time, I don't get to New Mexico very often, but one time I was working on immunization and I had a chance to come to this state and fly in a state plane all over the state doing immunization. And New Mexico is so beautiful. I would love to I've always wanted to bring my family back out here, but I don't know whether we could ever get a chance to fly over the country again like that.
Well,
that was great.
Let me say on behalf of everyone, you're a national treasure and an inspiration to us all. Please join me in thanking.
the lines will begin to form. And if you've enjoyed this evening, please let us know through the envelope in your program. And thank you again for coming. It's been a wonderful evening.